Okay, today I hope I'm audible. Okay, today we are going to talk about development of scientific agriculture in world and India. We are going to talk about the Green Revolution in India and revolutions which were related to agriculture and allied activities. It all began in India when sugarcane, cotton, and tobacco were grown for export purposes. Well, you have to remember important dates. In 1970, Joint Department of Agriculture, Revenue, and Commerce was established. From 1877 to 1878, there was a big famine. In 1880, Famine Commission was appointed and there was a recommendation for a separate Department of Agriculture, and thus the Department of Agriculture was established. It got momentum in the 19th century, the Department of Agriculture. Indian land tax was levied in the middle of the 19th century. These 6 states, 1887, 1878, 1889, 1892, 1897, 1900. In these years, there was a decrease in population because of continuous famines. Okay, so due to these famines, Britishers, they started various developmental programs. And these programs included railways, telegraph, and postal departments so that the communication and information can be transferred at a quicker rate. And so the raw material and food material can be transferred also at a quicker rate. So this was done during the Lord Dalhousie's duration in India. He constructed the Upper Bari Dobe Canal in Punjab. He laid roads and established public welfare departments. Improvement of agriculture started in his period, basically. In Lord Curzon's period, which is from 1898 to 1905, the Great Canal System of the Punjab was constructed. During his period, Imperial Agricultural Research Institute was started in Pusa, Samastipur district in Bihar in 1903. His period is called as the Golden Period in Agriculture in India. During his period, Department of Agriculture and Agricultural Colleges for provinces were started at Coimbatore, Pune, Kanpur, Nagpur, Lilipur. This was in around the year 1906. Similarly, Sugarcane Breeding Institute was established in 1912 at Coimbatore. There was an issue with IARI, which was there, which was the land area was earthquake prone. So IARI was shifted to New Delhi in 1936. In 1926, Royal Commission on Agriculture was set up, and the main function or the responsibility was to give recommendation. And these recommendations were associated with dugging canals or laying roads and all those things. Based on these recommendations, ICAR, which was called as the Imperial Council of Agricultural Research, it was started in 1929. The idea of ICAR, or Imperial Council of Agricultural Research, was to conduct agriculture-associated research. It was later termed as Indian Council for Agriculture Research, ICAR, which we call it today, and this happened after independence. Again, state agriculture universities were also started after 1960s, and ICAR also started research institutes of its own in different centers in India for various crops. There's going to be next issue. Okay, so in 1942, Department of Food was created to cope up with the difficult food situations in India. In 1945, Indian Meteorological Department was established for weather services for agriculture. In 1950, Planning Commission was set up. 1951, first five-year plan was implemented. After 1947, ICAR totally adapted to land grant. colleges. In 1962, a land grant college was started in Panthnagar in Uttar Pradesh. It was the first university with 16,000 acres of land. Between 1965 and 1967, Green Revolution started due to the introduction of high-yielding varieties of wheat, rice, and there was more use of fertilizers, there were constructions of dams, there were use of pesticides. So we're just going to look at the important events in the history of agriculture. So about 10,000 years before Christ, we human beings were simply hunters and gatherers. By 8700 BC, we started with the domestication of sheep. In around about 7700 BC, we started domesticating goat. 7500 BC, we started cultivating wheat and barley. And in the year 6000 BC, roundabout, we started with domestication of cattle and pigs. Around about year 4400 BC, we started cultivation of maize. And you can see 3500 BC, we started cultivation of potato. 3400 BC, the wheel was invented. Around about 3000 BC, bronze was used to make tools. And with the help of bronze and these things, the plow was invented. Irrigated farming started in around year 2900 BC. In 2700 BC, China started to domesticate silk moth. They started manufacturing and producing silk and silk clothes. Around about 2300 BC, cultivation of chickpea, pear, sarsen and cotton was done. By 2200 BC, domestication of fowl, buffaloes, elephants, and these were done. And we also started with cultivation of rice, cultivation of finger millet, ragi, jisko bolte hain, that started in around about 1800 BC. Cultivation of sorghum started with in around 1725 BC. By 1700 BC, we had started taming of the horses. 1500 BC, cultivation of sugar cane and was done. Irrigation from well also started during this time. 1400 BC, we started using iron. This helped a lot in improving the tillage of the soil. By 15th century AD, cultivation of sweet oranges, sour oranges, wild brinjal, pomegranate was all done. 16th century AD, introduction to several crops into India was done by the Portuguese. These included potatoes, sweet potatoes, arrowroot, cassava, tomato, chilies, pumpkin, papayas, pineapples, guavas, custard apple, even groundnut, tobacco, rubber, American cotton, all these things, they came from foreign countries to India. So some of the ancient literatures that explain about the Indian agriculture, these include your Bharat Sanhita, which was written in 500 AD by Vara Mahira, Agni Puran, which was written in 500 to 700 AD, Krishi Sangraha of Parasara, which was written in 500 to 1000 AD. Then we had Shukraniti, then Upvan Vinod, which was written in 2020 to 1330. Then you have Arthashastra by Kautilya. Then you have Krishi Sukti by Kashyap. You also have Vishwavallabha by Chakrapani. Then we had Mahabharat. We have Rig Veda. We have Atharveda. So these are the few of the literatures that explain about agriculture in their writings. Agriculture in ancient India, we'll start with land and soil. So Indians, we were pretty conscious about the soil and we knew about its relation to the production of a specific crops. And we knew how to go for, we knew about the economic importance of a good quality soil for a good quality of food product that can be grown. The vast knowledge was acquired by experiences and was handed over from generation to generation. The way of transferring this information was through maxim and proverbs from parents to children, and then from their children to their children. These were written in the form of poems and all these things. So soil, according to fertility, soil is at that point of time was mainly divided into urvara and anurvara, which is fertile and infertile. Further, urvara mrutiki is divided into different kind of soils according to their peculiar fitness for cultivation of a different type of crops. At those times the crops that were grown majorly were which were concentrated upon. One was yavya, which is called as barley, or til, you know what til is, and vrihi, which is called as rice. So these were amongst the major crops, and every crop required a different type of salt condition, right? So anurvara mrutiki, it was divided into two types, usra and maru, which is salty ground and desert ground. The exact chemical composition of different kinds of soil might obviously was not known because the chemistry aspect was not as advanced as it is now. But the observations with the help of type of soil, the soil texture, the soil particle size and all these things, the ability to retain water and all these things are the ancient writers and farmers, they knew about the different type of soils. So these knowledge, it was gathered, and they tried to inform about how they're going to work on it. For example, clay soils, it was informed that is suitable for jute or potatoes, okay, and it was also shown that if you are going to cultivate these by the side of bamboo grove, these are going to grow in a much better way. Then lands that are beaten by foam, that is river banks, are suitable for pumpkin, gourds, etc. Land frequently overflown by water for longer duration were good for pepper, grapes, sugarcane. So these were the information which Indian agriculturists at that point of time knew about. In Krishi Sukti, it's a comprehensive book on agriculture. It was written by Kashyap. It classified the land into wetlands and dry lands. So wetlands were for paddies. So they were Suli Bhumi, Chala Bhumi and Sasya Bhumi. And the dry land was called as Adhaka Bhumi. In Upan Vinod, the land is described as of three kinds, that is arid, wet and moderate. Each of these is further divided depending upon the color of the soil or the taste of the soil. So depending on what type of color was the soil or what type of taste was there or what type of smell was there, it was further divided into different types. Again, it was specified which type of crop or tree was suitable to which type of soil. For example, citron or punaka or champaka, amra or pomegranate were supposed to be grown on a moderate land, which is neither too wet or not too dry. So we knew about all these things. With reference to irrigation and drainage, we have the Gupta dynasty is known very well for this irrigation and drainage things. We've seen different serials associated with this, Chandragupta Maurya, and we'll just come to it. Okay. So with reference to irrigation, it's been informed in various different places and scattered in the whole and ancient literature of India. In the Rig Veda, we find many references to irrigation. Again, kuwa, that word comes into mention many times. Then there was a way of bringing a water from the wells with the help of wheel or water pails and strap, using those cows and donkeys to pull the water from these wells. Also by buckets tied by ropes to one end and long wooden pole working about a fulcrum near the other end. They carried the heavy weight. It is still used in some parts of India, Bibi. Another method was by small canoe, which is Sanadoni, we call that, tied by four strings and worked between two men standing on a wooden platform. the canoe is swung to and fro and the water comes out. And in Atharva Veda, such references are common. In Mahabharata also, the Sabha Parva mentions the mode of irrigation. In historical period, Megasthenes wrote, greater part of the soil is under irrigation and consequently grows two crops in India. In the Gupta dynasty, Lake Sudarshana was excavated during the regime of Chandragupta. His canals and irrigation system was completed by Ashoka the Great, they say. And there, the ruins are still found in many parts of the country. And these ruins have shown to be of real good importance. Yeah. So the location of water table for well is described for normal condition in arid areas, in marshy lands, in mountainous country. For example, by Chakrapani from Mathura. He further describes the construction of reservoir also in his book called as Vishwavalabha. So, let's talk about the National Agriculture Research Systems and the NARS and the ICAR and the mandates of ICAR, the research institutions and their mandates. So, ICAR, it was initially called as the Imperial Council of Agriculture Research. Now it's called as the Indian Council for Agricultural Research. It is an autonomous organization. It comes under the Department of Agricultural Research and Education, DARE, Ministry of Agriculture and Farmers Welfare. It comes under directly under the Government of India. It was formally, as we said, it was established on 16 July 1929 as a registered society under the Societies Registration Act of 1860. The headquarters of ICAR is located in New Delhi. The council is an apex body for coordinating, guiding and managing researches and education in agriculture, including agriculture. These includes horticultures, fisheries and animal sciences in the entire country. With around 101 ICAR institute and 78 agricultural universities spread across India, this is one of the largest national agricultural system in the world. This ICAR has played a major role in helping with the Green Revolution and other developments associated with the Green Revolution in India. And this was done because of the capability of the institution to organize and improve research and technology development. And we can say that there has been an increase of many folds in different food products between 1951 and 2014. For example, you can see that there's a 5 times food grain increment between 1951 and 2014. Similarly, there's been a 9.5 times increment in horticultural crops between 51 and 14. Similarly, fishes, milk, eggs have gone really high in the last 60 years, around 39 times what they were produced in 1951. They have grown up to 39 times as compared to that since 2014. So we can see that these institutions have actually made a visible impact on the national food and nutritional security. It has played a major role in promoting excellence in higher education and agriculture, and it is engaged in cutting-edge area of science and technology development, and its scientists are internationally acknowledged in their field. You have to understand that these organizations are very big, and they have scientists which have worked in a national and international level with different countries. They have tie-ups. So let's take a look at the mandates. So the mandates, if we talk about the mandates, the mandate includes planning and undertaking and coordinating and promoting research and technology development. This is one of the major aspects which is associated with ICAR. Then they help in aiding and imparting and coordinating agricultural education to enable high quality human resource development, which is very important, which as a student you are being taught. Then you have frontline extension of technology application, adoption, knowledge management and capacity development for agri-based rural development. So the idea is to extend the knowledge and application of the knowledge and adopt new techniques. How you're going to manage the knowledge which you have, all these things are part of ICAR norms. Then you have certain policies, cooperation and consultancies which are associated with ICAR. And these consultancies and cooperations are in between education institutions and ICAR and extension and agriculture research. So organization, the Union Ministry of Agriculture is the ex officio president of the ICAR Society. The secretary, Department of Agricultural Research and Education, Ministry of Agriculture, Government of India. And Director General ICAR is the Principal Executive Officer of the Council. Governing body is the Policy Making Authority. Okay. Let's start with Regional Agriculture Research Institution of ICAR, State Agriculture Universities. Let's take a look at these universities and national interest. So ICAR institutions, the deemed universities, National Research Center, which are called also called as NRCs, National Bureaucrats and Directorate, Project Directorates. So we have four deemed universities, which is one is in Delhi, another is in Karnal, third is in Izzatnagar, and fourth is in Mumbai. These are Indian Council for Agriculture, Indian Agriculture Research Institute, then you have, which is in Delhi, National Dairy Research Institute, NDRI, is in Karnal. IVRI, which is Indian Veterinary Research Institute, is in Izzatnagar. CIFE is Central Institute for Fishery Education, which is in Mumbai. And we have 64 institutes, and these include Central Island Agriculture Research Institute in Port Blair. We have Central Arid Zone Research Institute in Jodhpur. We have Central Avian Research Institute in Izzatnagar. Central Inland Fisheries Research Institute, Barakpur, Central Institute, Brackish Water Aquaculture, which is in Chennai, Central Institute for Research on Buffaloes is in Hisar, Central Institute for Research on Goats is in Makhdum, the Central Institute for Agriculture Engineering is in Bhopal, Central Institute for Arid Horticulture is in Bikaner. We have Central Institute of Cotton Research, which is in Nagpur. Central Institute of Fishery Technology is in Cochin. And you have Central Institute of Freshwater Aquaculture is in Bhubaneswar. Central Institute of Research on Cotton Technologies in Mumbai. Central Institute of Subtropical Horticulture is in Lucknow. Central Institute of Temperate Horticulture is Srinagar. Central Institute of Post-Harvest Engineering and Technologies in Ludhiana. The Central Marine Fishery Research Institute is in Kochi. Central Plantation Crop Research Institute is in Kasargod. Central Potato Research Institute is in Shimla. Central Research Institute for Jute and Allied Fibers is in Barakpur. Central Research Institute of Dryland Agriculture is in Hyderabad. National Rice Research Institute is in Cuttack. Central Sheep and Wool Research Institute is in Avikanagar, Rajasthan. Then you have Indian Institute of Soil and Water Conservation is in Dehradun. You have ICAR Central Soil Salinity Research Institute in Karnal. Central Tobacco Research Institute is in Rajahmundry. Central Tuber Crop Research Institute is in Trivandrum. Then you have ICAR Research Complex for Eastern Region. Mission, which is in Patna. Then ICR Research Complex for NEH region is in Barapani. Central Coastal Agriculture Research Institute is in Goa. Indian Agriculture Static Research Institute is New Delhi. Indian Grassland and Fodder Research Institute is in Jhansi. Indian Institute of Agricultural Biotechnology is in Ranchi. Indian Institute of Horticultural Research is in Bangalore. Indian Institute of National Raisin and Gums is in Ranchi. Indian Institute of Pulse Research is in Kanpur. Indian Institute of Soil Science is in Bhopal. The Indian Institute of Spices Research is in Calicut. Indian Institute of Sugarcane Research is in Lucknow. Indian Institute of Vegetable Research is in Varanasi. Indian Academy of Agricultural Research and Management is in Hyderabad. The National Institute of Biotic Stress Management is in Raipur. National Institute of Abiotic Stress Management is in Malegaon, which is in Maharashtra. The National Institute of Animal Nutrition and Physiology is in Bangalore. The National Institute of Research on Jute and Allied Fiber is in Kolkata. The National Institute of Veterinary Epidemiology and Disease Informatics is in Bangalore. The National Sugarcane Breeding Institute is in Coimbatore. The Vivekananda Krishi Anusandhan Sansthan is in Almora. The Central Institute of Research and Cattle is in Meerut, Uttar Pradesh. The National Institute of High Security Animal Disease is in Bhopal. The Indian Institute of Meat Research is in New Delhi. The Central Agroforestry Research Institute is in Jhansi. The National Institute of Agricultural Economics and Policy Research is in New Delhi. The Indian Institute of Wheat and Barley Research is in Karnal. The Indian Institute of Farming System Research is Modipuram. The Indian Institute of Millets Research is in Hyderabad. The Indian Institute of Oilseed Research is in Hyderabad. The Indian Institute of Oil Palm Research is in Padvegi, which is in West Godavari. And you have your Indian Institute of Water Management in Bhubaneswar. Indian Institute of Rice Research is in Hyderabad. Indian Central Institute for Women in Agriculture is in Bhubaneswar. Then you have Central Citrus Research Institute in Nagpur. You have Indian Institute of Seed Research in Mau. And finally, you have your Indian Agriculture Research Institute in Jharkhand. So you have these 64 ICR Indian Research Institutes. Okay. Then you have your 15 national NRCs, the National Research Centers. NRC of banana is in Trichy. For grapes, it is in Pune. For lychee, it is in Muzaffarpur. For pomegranate, it is Solapur. Camel, it is in Bikaner. Equines, it is in Hisar. Meat is in Hyderabad. Mithun is in Nagaland. Orchids is in Sikkim. Pig is Guwahati. Plant biotechnology is in New Delhi. Seed spices is Ajmer. Yak is in West Kimang. Pest management is again in New Delhi. And integrated farming is Motihari. You have your national directives, which includes plant genetic resources is in New Delhi. Agriculturally important microorganisms is in Mau, Uttar Pradesh. Agriculture insect resources is in Bangalore. Soil survey and land use planning is in Nagpur. Animal genetic resources is in Karnal. Fish genetic resources is in Lucknow. And you have your 13 project directorates. The Directorate of Groundnut Research is in Junagadh. Directorate of Soybean Research is in Indore. Directorate of Rapeseed and Mustard Research is in Bharatpur. Directorate of Mushroom Research is in Solan. Directorate of Onion and Garlic Research is Pune. Directorate of Cashew Research is in Puttur. Directorate of Medicinal and Aromatic Plant is in Anand. Directorate of Floriculture Research is in Pune, which is in Maharashtra. Directorate of Weed Research is in Jabalpur. Then you have Project Directorate on Foot and Mouth Disease in Mukteshwar. You have Directorate of Poultry Research in Hyderabad. Directorate of Knowledge Management in Agriculture, DKMA, this is in New Delhi. And you have your Directorate of Cold Water Fisheries Research, Bhimtal and Nainital. So we have list of agriculture universities in India. There are 78 in numbers. We'll start with them. Okay, so we are going to finish this here. In the next class, we will be talking about the list of agriculture universities in India, and we'll take it from there. Thank you.